Thank you all for coming tonight. For those of you who don't know me, I am not Steph Davis. I'm Sarah Wilson, a student in the Marine Science Department here at KAUST. Today I get the honor of introducing a remarkable woman, Steph Davis. Steph Davis was once a student, like many of us, who as a freshman in college at the University of Maryland, became interested in extreme sports. These included base jumping, wingsuit flying, and her first love, climbing. She'd spend the next 5 years honing her climbing skills while gaining a bachelor's and master's degree in English. After college, Steph traveled throughout the US and Patagonia, climbing some of the most intimidating mountain peaks. After college, she eventually became a professional athlete, gaining many sponsorships. Steph Davis is truly an inspiration, as her accomplishments show what we can do with determination and focus. She was the first woman to summit some of the most difficult peaks in Patagonia. She was the second to free climb El Capitan, a 90-meter vertical rock formation found in Yosemite, California, and she did this in just one day. Her most remarkable achievement to me was done in Long's Peak, Colorado, where she climbed solo, without any ropes, the Diamond, a 270-meter high-altitude vertical climb of extreme difficulty. These feats highlight a career of pushing boundaries and represent just a small piece of the life's work of a remarkable woman I am proud to introduce. So without further ado, Steph Davis. Thank you.
I'm a professional climber and a base jumper. I climb up cliffs and I jump off them. This wasn't a career I ever expected to be in, and in fact, until I was 18, I didn't even know what extreme sports were. The first day I went climbing was my first year of college, and I was sitting outside the cafeteria at University of Maryland with my mountain bike when a guy walked up and asked if I wanted to go rock climbing. It was winter, but it was unseasonably warm and sunny, so I skipped calculus class and went, mainly to find out what rock climbing was and also because this guy was pretty attractive. I fell head over heels in love with rock climbing. And it turns out that rock climbing is where you go and climb up rocks. Until that moment, I thought I was going to become a concert pianist. I'd been studying music since the age of 3, and I spent most of my childhood and teenage years on a piano bench in a little practice room by myself, practicing up to 6 hours a day by the time I was in high school. Aside from piano, my main hobby was reading. I didn't play any sports. I wasn't on any teams. This may not seem like the ideal background for becoming a professional athlete, but classical music training taught me how to practice, how to focus on making an impossible thing become possible by breaking it into small parts and then working at them relentlessly. That first day of climbing somewhat exploded life as I knew it. Within a year, I had quit music completely, changed my major to English, and signed up for a student exchange program to Colorado State University to get out west because I assumed there would be more rocks and mountains out there than in Maryland, which luckily turned out to be true. I got a master's degree at CSU in mountaineering literature, and in 1995, I went to law school for a week. And then I dropped out and I moved into my grandma's hand-me-down Oldsmobile so I could climb as much as possible. In my first decade of climbing, I dedicated my life to it completely. I waited tables to earn money and then spent months living out of my car in climbing areas around the US. I eventually started to get a little bit of financial support from climbing companies as the outdoor industry developed, allowing me to really move up from a lifestyle perspective to a used Ford Ranger pickup truck with my dog Fletch. One of the main things that I hear from people, friends, family, strangers that I meet is we all just want to be happy and fulfilled in life. And for many of us, following our dreams means that we have to step off the safe road at some point and take an enormous risk. We've all found ourselves in that moment wondering if we should stay on the safe road or go for our dreams. Most people, especially the people who love you, will tell you not to step off that safe road, to fit in, to be like everybody else around you. People will tell you that your dream is impossible or crazy. There aren't any roadmaps usually, and there are endless obstacles. Even now, after 25 years of climbing in the mountains, leaving law school to live in a car was one of the scariest things I've ever done in my life. But I did know I had to follow my heart, so that's what I did. Over the next decade of climbing, I said yes to any opportunity that came my way to travel the world and climb big walls and mountains. I knew how to work really hard. It's what I learned as a student and as a musician. And I also discovered that when you're following your dream, you have limitless energy for anything, no matter how hard it might be. I went to the Karakoram and climbed Shipton Spire in Pakistan, a 4,000-foot granite tower with the summit at 20,000 feet in altitude. I spent 3 weeks living on the side of a wall in the Arctic Circle above frozen sea ice and polar bears in Baffin Island. I went to Kyrgyzstan, back to Pakistan a second time to find more unclimbed granite spires. All of these climbs were first ascents, thousands of feet tall, so there was always a lot of uncertainty involved and a lot of work. But when you go off on expeditions like this, you learn that just as with classical music, very big projects happen by taking many small steps, by simply starting and then continuing until you get there, wherever there may be. The place that taught me the most about the importance of persevering was the Patagonian Andes, which is a mountain chain in Chile and Argentina that separates the Atlantic and the Pacific Oceans. Storms circle around these oceans, and then they come in and slam into the first landmass they meet, these jagged granite towers that stick straight up out of the glaciers. There's no place in the world that can prepare you for the weather in these mountains. Even when the skies are looking pure blue like this, the wind can be raging on top of those peaks, thousands of feet up. And when the skies aren't pure blue, there's snow, ice, and sleet in the mix. These are the stormiest mountains in the world. The winds can reach speeds of up to 60 miles an hour, and you can stay there for 3 months and see one day of good weather the whole time. Patagonia is the wildest and most frustrating place I've ever climbed, and I do think that's part of the attraction. The first expedition I ever went on was to Patagonia in 1996, and what I wanted more than anything was to climb Fitzroy, the biggest mountain there. It's 6,000 feet of granite, ice, and snow. My partner on this trip, Charlie Fowler, was a very experienced alpinist, and he had climbed in Patagonia before, but he hadn't yet stood on top of Fitzroy either, so he shared my goal. For 2 months through December and January, it stormed so much we could only climb smaller peaks, and we never even saw a big enough weather window to try for Fitzroy at all. In the last week of our trip there, the weather wasn't looking great, and the conditions on the mountain also looked pretty bad, with snow and ice covering all the rock. But we were running out of time, and we felt like we had to at least try to climb this mountain that was our real goal. We started up Fitzroy, climbed all day, and spent a night in an ice cave that we chipped out with our ice axes on the side of the mountain. We woke that morning to light snow, and we had enough food for one more day. But we thought maybe if we stayed in the ice cave for another day and waited, there may be a chance at reaching a summit the following day And so, despite the lack of food and water, we decided to spend one more night in the ice cave. We woke to weather that was cloudy, but it was calm. And we made the decision to keep climbing and go up instead of deciding to go down in this semi-good weather. The decision was a gamble. We had one package of cookies left for food to climb another 2,000 feet and then descend 5,000 feet. And as we climbed, the clouds came in and the wind started up. We were so close to the summit at that point that we still kept climbing, trying to race the weather. But the storm got worse until the wind and the sleet were so bad that we had no choice finally but to retreat, fighting our way back down the mountain for hours in a terrible storm. And we almost didn't make it down at all when our ropes actually blew off the mountain during the retreat. We failed to reach the summit of Fitzroy, but we succeeded in getting down alive, and I learned a huge lesson about risk and commitment. We really had no reserves of energy when we found ourselves having to fight down the storm because we kept going even when we knew we should probably turn back. We pushed past the point where we could have retreated more safely. I learned that when you choose to put yourself into a high commitment situation, you need to make sure you have some margin for the unexpected. And I also learned that really big goals rarely happen on the first try, no matter how much you might want them to. Success is something that usually comes from a lot of work and a lot of failure, often years of it. I returned to Patagonia for 7 grueling winters in a row, spending 1 to 3 months there every winter, living in rock shelters and ice caves and eating oatmeal and dehydrated soup. I had different climbing partners, different strategies, and eventually I did stand on top of not just Fitzroy, but all 7 of the peaks in the Fitzroy Range, which is the majestic skyline of that mountain chain. They say that success is 1% inspiration and 99% perspiration. To me, that translates to 1% standing on a summit and 99% fighting your way through storms, sitting in snow caves, and carrying big backpacks up and down glaciers. Patagonia scared me, frustrated me, and it beat me down quite a bit, but it also shaped me as a climber and as a person, and it shaped my approach to life. As a pianist and a straight-A student, I hated making mistakes. In Patagonia, I discovered that every failure is a chance to learn and to get stronger. The summits that I reached there came only because of all the failed attempts that I had made to reach them. It is easy to get discouraged in the failures, especially when you're wet, cold, scared, and exhausted. And it can be hard to keep the goal in sight. But in those harsh mountains, I learned that above all, if you just keep going, you will always get there eventually. To climb well in any place, you have to take the time to get to know the place, and you have to adapt to it. Often, we as humans imagine we can change the world to suit us in every way. But in fact, if you want to succeed at anything, you have to understand your environment, and you have to change yourself to adapt to that environment. The way you climb in Patagonia is completely different than the way you climb in sunny California, for example. El Capitan in Yosemite, California is the largest vertical cliff face in North America. It's 3,000 feet tall with a convenient road at the bottom just out of the frame of this photo and with the kind of weather you expect from California. It's also the most famous cliff in America and maybe even the world for climbers. People actually spend several days on the side of the wall, and typically they climb their ropes and their equipment to ascend the face. This style of climbing is called aid climbing because you are climbing with the aid of the equipment instead of using only the rock itself. Last year, El Capitan actually made international headlines when 2 climbers free climbed a route called the Dawn Wall, meaning they used only their bodies to climb the rock itself with the ropes and the equipment just there for safety. But Over 20 years ago, in 1994, Lynn Hill became a legend in the climbing world when she became the first person to free climb El Cap in a single day. She had a partner to ascend up the rope behind her, but she did all the climbing herself. 3,000 feet of sheer vertical movement from bottom to top in under 24 hours without ever falling onto her rope. This was not long after I started climbing, and El Cap free in a day was the most significant thing that had ever happened in the rock climbing world, ever. Kind of still is. El Cap free in a day seemed like such an unattainable dream, but after my time in Patagonia, I learned that discipline and total commitment can make anything possible. In 2003, almost 10 years after Lynn's achievement, I freed El Cap in 22 hours, becoming the second woman to free climb El Cap in a day, and so far there hasn't been a third. Doing something I was sure was impossible for me made me set my sights on an even bigger dream, free climbing an even more difficult route up El Cap, the legendary Salathe Wall. Only a handful of other climbers had ever free climbed this route, none of them female, so it was an intimidating goal for me. And I decided to keep the same mentality I'd had when free climbing El Cap in a day 2 years before I took on the Salathe Wall. I decided I had to focus on the process rather than the goal. Otherwise, it would be just too overwhelming. And it's just like music, it's just like any difficult project, breaking it into small parts, bit by bit, using discipline and practice to slowly move forward. My partner on this climb was a girl named Sabelle, whom I had met while walking around on top of El Cap a few days I was ready to go for the route. And just finding a random stranger to go along with you on the hardest climb of your life isn't exactly a traditional tactic, and definitely not the guaranteed way to do it. But Sabelle turned out to be the best partner I ever could have asked for. She was a less experienced climber, but she truly understood the meaning of partnership, and she did everything in her power to help me reach my goal. I originally planned to spend 5 days climbing the Salathe from bottom to top, and it turned into 10 days. We got caught in a storm almost immediately, having to decide whether to stay up or go down. We got slowed down by aid parties who were also climbing the wall using the older, slower climbing methods. And then I kept falling on the hardest sections of the route and having to go back down and try again, getting more and more run down. When you're living on the side of a wall, it's hard to recover physically. You can't just go home at the end of the day and eat a nice dinner, take a hot shower, do some yoga. You sit there on the side of the wall and scrub your hands off with baby wipes and eat some dehydrated soup, try to get comfortable on a rock ledge until it's time to shove your climbing shoes back on and try again. We were just a few hundred feet below the top, but I was getting defeated again and again on the hardest part of the climb. We ran out of food, we ran out of water, and I said it was time to retreat, but Sabelle wouldn't hear of it. She climbed up ropes to the top of El Cap. She hiked several hours down into Yosemite Valley. She went to the grocery store. She hiked back up with more food and water and came back and brought it down so that I could have one more try. At that point, I had one more day to try, and I couldn't let Sabelle's effort go to waste. So on the last day, I managed to do the hardest sections of the climb and get to the top of El Cap. These El Cap free routes were huge, difficult climbs, 3,000 feet of climbing up a sheer granite wall that I definitely would have said were impossible for me to do before I did them. And they were also challenges that proved to me, if you can focus on something completely to the exclusion of everything else and dedicate yourself to it completely, you are most likely going to end up doing it, no matter how impossible it may be. It may take years, but if you never stop going, you will get there. Even more importantly, my experience in the Salathe with Sabelle taught me the importance of having and being a true partner. Climbing has grown enormously since the first day that I went in college 25 years ago. 6.8 million people went climbing in the US last year. And an estimated 30 million people climb every year around the world. Climbing has just been added to the 2020 Olympics. 20 years ago, climbing was a fringe sport, but not anymore. Climbing is now very common. Climbing without a rope is not common. Free solo climbing is different from what we call free climbing, simply and only because you don't have a rope. If you fall, there is nothing to catch you. It's an extremely interesting type of climbing because it's so mental. Once the rope is gone, everything changes. Climbers struggle with fear of falling and fear of failure. Fear is complicated. On the one hand, it can keep us from doing things that are dangerous that maybe we shouldn't do. But on the other hand, it can stop us from doing things that we want to do and that we can do. Some people freeze up or find it impossible to perform well because fear is so strong. Trying to sort through this conflict has been a big part of climbing for me, and it's one reason I've always been drawn to free solo climbing. Often people like the idea of just going for it in scary situations, but I've usually found that's a terrible idea, doing something when you're afraid because you're afraid. It usually backfires. When you're really afraid, you don't perform as well, and that is dangerous, and you should be afraid. It's natural to want quick solutions and immediate results, but that's not how it works. Dealing with fear is a lifetime practice. There's no such thing as being fearless or eliminating fear. We need to learn how to accept fear and how to control ourselves when we're feeling it. So how do we reduce fear and find a way to be safe when we're feeling it? I think most fear we experience is fear of the unknown, and reducing fear comes slowly over time by reducing the unknowns in a situation. If there's something I want to do that's really intimidating, I start by analyzing exactly what I need to do in order to do it safely, and then I systematically prepare and train for every one of those parts. By breaking down the project into specific elements and preparing for each one, I take out a majority of the unknowns and the doubts, and I become less intimidated.
Crimson and clover, would you come walking over?
The diamond can be an intimidating place. There's some loose rock. The climbing is pretty steep. It's vertical or overhanging. If you fell off, you'd go down about 1,000 feet. If I think to myself, oh, what about falling? Either I'm gonna be distracted or potentially nervous, so I can't do that. The fear is the danger. Fear is strongly connected to confidence, and I think that's where we get fooled sometimes. I've met a lot of people who are very confident, and yet many times that confidence is not based on actual ability or experience. In extreme environments, overconfidence is very dangerous. I've also met a lot of people who are highly competent, but they don't believe in their own ability, and they can't reach higher. I think of confidence like salt. Without it, food has no flavor, but with too much, the food is inedible. The biggest challenge of confidence and fear is learning how to honestly assess ourselves and our environments and understanding when it's appropriate to push harder and when it's not.
And of all the styles of climbing, maybe the best way to get to that place is free soloing.
Got no time, got no mind.
To be able to free solo something, that is an expression of being so in control that you know you're gonna be able to do it without falling. There is a pretty strong mental dialogue and a pretty strong engagement with fear.
Time to sink with.
It's hard to push past that fear. It's something that for me takes a lot of thought, a lot of preparation, and I don't have to be paralyzed by fear. I can just go do it. Confidence and fear are also linked to risk, and risk is something that we all deal with every day. The idea of managing risk became much more defined in my life when I started jumping out of airplanes. At first, I just saw skydiving as a tool to face my fears of falling, but I quickly fell in love with it. I went through a training course at a skydiving center in Colorado, and then I just stayed there for 3 months and jumped out of airplanes every day until I was able to start flying a wingsuit, which is basically a nylon superhero suit with wings between your arms and your legs. It's more dangerous and more difficult to skydive with a wingsuit on, so you are required to make 200 skydives with your regular clothes before you can start learning how to fly a wingsuit. I'm sure everyone has seen YouTube videos of wingsuit flying and wondered what it feels like to fly one. It literally feels like you're flying because you are flying. The suit creates more surface area, and the bigger the suit, the more surface area you have. So depending on the size of your suit and how well you fly it, you can stay in the air up to 3 times as long as somebody without a suit on. You can turn, dive down, pop up, do barrel rolls, and fly in formation with your friends like jet fighters. In a big wingsuit, you're usually going forward about 90 miles per hour and going down about 30 miles per hour. And you can fly for a couple of miles before it's time to pull your parachute and land. Because my home in Moab, Utah is surrounded by rock walls and cliffs, and I spend most of my time on cliffs anyway, I soon progressed from jumping out of airplanes to jumping off cliffs. Base jumping is considered more dangerous than skydiving, but for me, I feel more at home on rocks than in airplanes. A climber's biggest fear is falling. So becoming a base jumper whose goal is to fall really changed my perspective and made me see how much perspective affects our view of the world. After learning how to skydive with a wingsuit and then learning how to jump from cliffs, it wasn't long before I got into the most extreme form of the air sports, which is flying a wingsuit off of cliffs. You walk up a mountain carrying your parachute, wingsuit, helmet, water, food, warm clothes on your back. At the top, you put on your wingsuit and your parachute. You evaluate the wind and the cliff. You decide where you plan to fly and where you hope to land. And then pull down your helmet, Take a deep breath and push off the edge into the air. At first, you fall for about 2 seconds, and then you snap open your arm and your leg wings to allow them to fill up with air, and then you shoot forward and you're flying. The most intense moment of any jump that you make is making the decision to go, knowing that once you leave the edge, you can't go back. Gravity only goes one way. Wingsuit-based jumping has gained a reputation as one of the most dangerous things a person can do. And many people can't understand the attraction at all. But imagine this, you could hike up to the top of a mountain, get dressed up in a squirrel suit, dive off the edge, and if you do it mostly correctly, you will fly. What I can't understand is, how would anyone not want to do this? Most people don't realize about wingsuit-based jumping is the hardest thing is not pushing off the edge of the cliff. It's deciding when to turn around, walk back down, and not do the jump because the winds aren't quite right, or clouds are building up, or you're simply not feeling 100% for any reason. If the conditions are reducing the safety margins, if I don't have a lot more than I need from my training and preparation, I decide to walk down. And it's a lot of effort to walk back down if you've spent 4 hours carrying a pack straight up a mountain. But I've been doing high-risk activities for 25 years, and deciding when to walk away is the most important skill I have. It's one of the hardest things in life, too, investing in something, really wanting it, working very hard to get it, taking risks that are intimidating and committing, feeling like you're almost there, and then realizing that it's time to let go, time to pull back. But the reality of life is that sometimes you do everything right, you take calculated risks carefully, and you lose. Some of you here have had a crushing loss. Some are experiencing one right now. Others are going to have one at some unknown, unforeseeable moment with no warning whatsoever. I've had many failures, and I've also had some big loss in my life, and I've learned that we are incredibly resilient, and we can handle more than we think we can. Everyone fails, and everyone falls. And everyone faces that time when it seems like there is just no way to keep going. And then you pick yourself up and you keep going. Through base jumping, I met my future husband, Mario. Mario was a legendary jumper. He was kind, humble, competent, and the most curious person I've ever met. Mario was a pilot. He was French-Canadian, raised in Quebec, and he started skydiving at the age of 18, becoming a pioneer in the early days of base jumping. He eventually became perhaps the most respected and experienced jumper in the sport, which really developed in the late 80s. Mario was famous among base jumpers for being incredibly active for almost 30 years without ever having been hurt. He put more thought into safety than anyone I had ever jumped with, and he also did more radical stuff than anyone I'd ever known. People would say, "Base jumping seems safe the way Mario does it." And he'd always say, "Well, we do our best, but of course it's not safe. We're jumping off a cliff." We met in 2008, and we were married in 2011. In the 5 years that we had together, we were never apart. Mario was my partner in everything. We were both very busy people, but we went into high gear together after we got married. In 2012, we started a business together, went through the process of getting Mario's US citizenship completed. We adopted a rescue puppy, renovated my house in Moab, and built a small cabin on 20 acres of land in the desert nearby. I wrote my second book. In August of 2013, we were flying in the Italian Dolomites together, which was a trip that we did every summer. We were on the top of a peak on a perfect sunny day, no wind, everything perfect. I jumped first, and Mario followed me. When I landed, he wasn't there. I waited for about 5 minutes and then called for a helicopter. The Italian search and rescue doctor later told me that he had tried to fly through a notch in the mountain, the same one he had flown over twice the day before, but he hit it 10 feet too low. To me and to everyone who knew Mario, it didn't make sense at all. For him to miscalculate his height so massively, it was the equivalent of reaching out to shake somebody's hand and just missing it completely. Mario had worn glasses all his life, and he had just switched to contacts right before this trip. And the day before when we had landed, he'd asked me to help look for his contact because he thought it had fallen out of his eye and he was searching around inside of his goggles. I looked and I found it exactly in place on his left eye, which was his bad eye. I've been told since then that having a dramatic difference in vision between your two eyes can take away your depth perception, which is obviously crucial when moving at high speeds in a three-dimensional environment. And I've also been told that vision can start to change dramatically and significantly overnight in some cases. So those are the only answers that I have. I had never even imagined a future without Mario. Of the two of us, he was the one I'd never worried about anything happening to. I took a lot of time to examine my life and my path after I lost Mario, and what I realized was that I am incredibly lucky to be living a life completely in line with my dreams. And I'm incredibly lucky that I knew Mario, someone I loved and admired more than anyone I'd ever known. And I came to fully understand that most things in life are not in our control. Things just happen. We don't choose most things that happen, but we always choose how we feel. That's a simple thing to say, and it's unimaginably hard to choose happiness in the face of loss. And it can't happen all at once, because nothing big or difficult ever happens all at once. But when we decide how we want to feel, it's the same thing as deciding we want to go climb to the top of a peak in some foreign country. Simply deciding to go there is the first step. And with every step forward, we get closer until one day we're there. It's just how it works. The more loss you experience and the more challenges you meet, the more you gain perspective on what really matters, which is simply doing the best you can all the time. We all want to be more resilient, and over time, we are. I fly and climb now with more clarity and with more gratitude than ever before. And that's the way I live, too. I love the mountains, and I love the air. I understand the risks of doing impossible things, perhaps more than anyone. And I can truly say I'm happier in life than I've ever been before. Only 1% of life is standing on the summit. 99% of it is really hard. But we are making choices with every thought we have. There's one thing that's true for everyone, and that's everything starts with you. It doesn't matter what thing you want to do, as long as it's the thing that lights you up more than anything else. There will always be outside forces, like wind, like snow, like other people, creating obstacles for you and making it hard to go forward. And there will always be the internal obstacles too, your own doubts, your own fears. What matters is that you trust in your passion and commit to it completely. If you just start going and keep going, you can do impossible things. None of us are born with wings, but all of us can choose to fly.
Thank you, Steph, for that amazing talk. Does anyone have any questions?
There's a little one way back there.
When did you start base jumping?
I started base jumping 10 years ago.
There's one way up in the front. Wait for the mic.
Thank you for breathtaking speech. I have a practical question. Do you leave any belongings on the top of the mountain before jumping in the suit from there? Do you leave any your belongings that you go to the mountain with? No.
No, that's part of the challenge, is that you have to pack only what you think that you can jump with. And so you try to be very minimalistic about what you take. And then you put everything inside your suit before you jump.
There's one in the back there.
I have a question for you. I was wondering if you have any advice for parents in how to encourage their children to have a good respect for fear, but also the confidence that they need to take risks as they grow and develop.
I think it's important for all of us to learn how to take risks in a responsible way, and I think that you can only do that by taking them. But I think the key word is responsible, and I think when you have kids who are small and they're in the process of developing, I think it's even more challenging to create situations for them where they can take risks, but they're still protected ultimately. But I think that's the best approach.
Good evening, Martin May. I'm faculty in earth sciences here, and lovely talk, amazing images. Thanks so much. As a climber myself, I'm really touched. What I'd like to know is, when you do the free soloing, so you're climbing without the actual ropes, do you train on the specific routes before? So do you know exactly where you're going, or you're doing this the first time you're going up that route?
If I'm doing something that's relatively easy for me, I will just go do it without having done it before. But if I think it's at all difficult for me, I make sure that I climb at first with a rope at least once, so there aren't surprises that I don't expect.
So one time climbing that, you mentioned that 1,000 feet cliff in the video where we saw you climbing up. You did that once or twice, and then you decide, let me do it without a rope.
Yeah.
All right. Something to learn. Thank you.
Thank you. Very inspiring. When you jump off the cliff, can you hear me? Yes. When you jump off the cliff, does time change? Does it speed up? Or does it slow down?
Yeah, your perception and your awareness really change. So one reason it's nice to jump very consistently is that you desensitize your anxiety and you have more awareness. When you jump in the beginning, or if you're very nervous, or if you're not what we call current, you're so overwhelmed that you kind of miss everything. When you feel comfortable and relaxed, you're very aware of everything, maybe hyper aware, because your brain is in a really intense situation.
Thank you, it's very inspiring.
Well, thank you very much for this touching and inspiring story, and I feel sorry for your loss.
Thank you.
My question is, when you get to, to have major achievement in climbing a rock or something, I wonder, how do you, document it? Is there like a legal way, or rather than just maybe signing your name on the top of the rock?
They do typically have summit registers on tops of towers and mountains, a little metal box with a notebook, and a lot of times people will write their name if they want to do that. Otherwise, taking pictures is a good way to remember.
Thank you.
What goes through your head just before you jump? Do you have some mental routines, or what goes through your head just before you take that step?
Before I jump, I always spend some time evaluating, and so I am very analytical about the conditions, about the site. I think a lot about my flight line if I'm in a wingsuit, and I always plan my outs. So I have a plan A where I'm going to fly the line I want to fly, I'm going to land where I want to land. I also have a plan B in case I get going and I'm not flying how I want to be flying. Like an exit line to be able to bail out, and hopefully even a plan C, and then the same with the landing. And so if I pick all these plans before I jump, it's really easy to immediately go into one of them instead of having to decide when things are happening fast. And so I spend some time analyzing, and once I get all that settled, then I kind of stop the analyzing, just take a deep breath and try to think very positive about things going well, and then usually I wait a little bit. I try to feel the wind some more, so I'm not rushing. And then if things are good, I'll go.
Thank you. Thank you very much for this very impressive talk. I'm here.
Ah.
Thank you. It's very, very impressive. So, what is your next challenge? Next step.
I don't have a plan to change what I'm doing. I really like what I'm doing right now, and so.
So you're not going for the highest peak and the highest mountain and high and steeper cliff or something like that.
No, I'm not very drawn to what I call the firstest, the fastest, and the mostest. I feel like especially today with the social media and so many voices, I feel like there can become this hamster wheel of always looking for something that you can say, I did the first and the best and the fastest. And I feel like that's a little artificial, and it's also kind of exhausting. For me, I'm really after an experience, and also after this freedom, this life, and sustainability. So, sometimes I happen to do something that is a first or something, but that's really not the goal for me.
Thank you very much. Carry on.
Thank you very much for your inspiring sharing and rock climbing and the race falling is kind of like your career and the most important thing in your life. So when you decided to do this, have you ever considered how to make a living? And if you like you given up your music career, kind of like?
When I started climbing and you know, like I talked about, moved into a car and started waiting tables. I didn't have a plan at all. I didn't predict that, you know, 25 years later I would be a successful professional athlete, and that it would become a career. People weren't even, there wasn't such a career. So I was really just kind of going for it and doing it because I loved doing it. And then over time, the pieces came together and it did evolve into a career. So I guess what I learned from that is that you don't always know what's going to happen in life. You know, it wasn't guaranteed that it would work out for me that way, but also I think in some ways if you do follow what really drives you, you will probably be successful because you are going to work harder and you are going to be more passionate about it. And so it wasn't a plan for me. I was just pursuing what I loved doing.
I'm sure you've seen the video about the individual who jumped off Chamonix, France, hit a tree and survived. I'm wondering if you've had any close calls yourself that made you take a break afterward out of either fear or analysis or something like that.
No, I haven't. I'm very, very careful with flying because I understand that, you know, small choices can have really big outcomes and really small mistakes can magnify really quickly. So no, I haven't had something like hitting a tree, and if I did, I would stop flying for a while and, you know, kind of think about what I had done if I was lucky enough to walk away from that.
Is there some place in Saudi Arabia or the Middle East that you'd like to climb or jump?
I don't know that much about this area. I've been contacted by a couple people that have told me there is climbing in Saudi Arabia, which I didn't know about before, and it sounds really interesting.
Thank you so much. This was incredible. You just said that you're not necessarily looking for the first or the biggest or the fastest or record-breaking or anything, but that rather you're looking for an experience. So I'm interested in what the ingredients are for you of what an attractive jump is, right? If it's not the record breaking or the firstness of it, what particularly turns you on about wanting to climb or jump from a particular tower or spire? Yeah, what's exciting for you?
Well, especially with jumping, what makes me really happy is that when I plan what I want to happen on the jump and I do a perfect job and the conditions are perfect and everything lines up, and when I land, I just say, that was amazing. The opposite experience would be if I made a bad choice in some way or didn't perform well or maybe had some bad conditions and kind of felt like more the feeling of getting away with it. For me, that's really terrible, and I don't like that at all.
Mountain you've ever climbed?
The tallest mountain I've ever climbed was Shipton Spire in Pakistan, and that is the one I talked about where the summit was 20,000 feet altitude.
Hello, thank you very much for a wonderful presentation. How do you land? Do you have a video showing when you're landing? Something you can share to all of us?
I don't have one right here. The way you land is you always have a parachute and you pilot the parachute to the place that you want to land. And then when you're about 30 feet above the ground, you take your steering lines and start gradually pulling on them all the way down. And that pulls up the back of the parachute and makes it cup air and then picks you up a little bit. So if the timing is right, you very softly touch the ground.
Have you done any other sports?
I really like trail running, and so I do that quite a bit. And I also really like skate skiing, Nordic skiing, and so in the winter I do that.
Hello. Thank you for this very, very, very nice speech and very emotional speech. My question, what the maximum speed can the human being reach in the air?
So with the wingsuit, the human body falls 120 miles per hour terminal straight down without a wingsuit, and that's just what it does. If you put weight on your body, you could fall faster than 120, but that's how fast your body would fall. So with the wingsuit, you're taking away that down speed and you're turning it into forward speed. So if you go forward 90 miles an hour, you're coming down 30. If you're going forward 100 miles an hour, you're going down 20. So you're always playing with that number. So when you fly a wingsuit, you're going forward usually about 100 miles an hour, more or less.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Mm-hmm.
Hi, thank you very much for your talk. It's very inspiring. I was just wondering, when you're on the top of a mountain, what makes it like the good environment to jump? What are the...
The worst thing for jumping is always wind. And we can take a little wind, a certain amount in a wingsuit, but what you don't really want is strong winds, and you don't want strong crosswinds. So, and you don't want a lot of turbulence. So that's, it's tricky too, because you may know what the wind is doing on the top, but you aren't necessarily knowing what the wind is doing everywhere you're flying. So if there's wind at all, it kind of tips you off that there's things you can't see that you're going into. Aside of that, the worst problem, a little more obvious, is clouds, because you do need to see where you're going. Sometimes where it's complicated is if the clouds are coming in and out, and they open and they close, and you can see different layers. So it gets complicated because you want to wait for an opening to go, but you're not quite sure how long those are going to be.
Excuse me?
Do you think that it can be possible to land without a parachute? Challenge be overcome one day?
There you go. Everyone sounds like they're coming from here for me. An English guy did land without a parachute, I want to say 2 years ago. He was a stuntman, and the way stuntmen do the big falls for the movies is they make piles of cardboard boxes, and then they fall onto the pile of boxes. So it wasn't very glamorous, but what he did was he made a big pile of cardboard boxes, and then he flew his wingsuit and slowed it down, and then he fell into the boxes. So it definitely wasn't glamorous, but he did technically land the wingsuit.
Thank you for sharing us with this great moments from you. You are a hero. My question is, did you face difficult moments during your jumping or climbing? And you said, okay, I shouldn't be in this way?
In that particular moment, do you
mean? Yeah, one moment that you face a difficult or real problem in your jumping? I mean, dangerous situation.
Okay. Like I said, I try to be really cautious with jumping. And a lot of times, base jumpers who more grew up as a base jumper first, it can be a lot to go to the top of a mountain to jump. And sometimes people feel pressured to jump because they're afraid to go back down, or other people in the group are going to jump, so they might be left alone, and they don't want to go down alone. For myself, I'm lucky because I grew up as a climber. I climb alone in the mountains. So one nice thing for me is I never care if I have to hike down. It never stops me. You know, maybe it's tiring or annoying. Even if I'm left alone, I don't care. I'll walk down. So I don't ever do a jump that I feel isn't going to be a good thing for me. And I have walked down quite a bit.
Great. An amazing presentation. Thank you very much. I hope you won't leave Arabia without climbing some of the amazing rock faces we have in Northwest Arabia. They look a lot like Zion's Park,
oh, wow.
Utah. Amazing. There's an old guy who works for Aramco. He's in his 70s. who's actually climbed some of these. He's the only person to ever climb them, but they're really beautiful, and you should at least take a look at them. Thank you again.
Thanks. One last question? Do we have one last question? Go ahead.
Thank you for your talk. How do you plan these flights where you go really close to the ground and through the trees? And
Usually with those, you have to study a lot before you do it, and you do the jump several times. So typically with a jump, the first time you do it, you do kind of a scouting run where you intentionally fly very high, and you see how high you are, you see how far you get before you dive down closer and closer. So, you know, typically it happens gradually. You don't always do a jump and like immediately go into the trees. It's usually after having done it a few times. That's kind of the conservative way to do it.
All right, I lied. One more question up here front.
Okay. Thank you very much for this presentation, very inspiring. I skydived once, I paraglided once, and I thought I was fearless. Looking at the pictures and the videos, I changed my mind. I have a question. Was there a moment in your life that either because of fear or some other reason, that you thought about quitting this experience and deciding to stop? And if so, how did you overcome it?
I really didn't know if I would fly wingsuits again after Mario died, just because I didn't know if I would enjoy that anymore. And so it took me several months before I even thought about it. And I finally thought, well, you know, at a certain point, I just have to see if I still like this thing. Otherwise, I don't know, right? You can't just hide away from it. So really for that reason, I went and, went skydiving at first with my wingsuit. It's, you know, it's something I love, and I felt that. But then I wondered if I would be base jumping a wingsuit again after that experience, you know, such a bad experience. And, you know, again, I felt I had to try to see what it felt like. And when I went back to base jumping a wingsuit, you know, it's a thing I love. And so I didn't want to stop doing it.
Thank you so much.